हेलो प्रिंस, वेलकमिंग ऑल बैक टू जियास पोटेंशियल बिल्डर करंट अफेयर्स प्रिंस प्रोग्राम फॉर यूपीएससी प्रीलिम्स 2021। दिस इज द 10th सेशन ऑफ आवर सीरीज। एज यूजुअल इन द डिस्क्रिप्शन वी आर प्रोवाइडिंग यू विद आवर टेलीग्राम चैनल लिंक वेयर वी विल बी पोस्टिंग क्वेश्चंस ऑन अ डेली बेसिस एज वेल एज अदर एग्जाम रिलेटेड इन्फॉर्मेशन। सो फॉर रेगुलर अपडेट्स एंड क्विक रिविजन फॉलो अस ऑन टेलीग्राम एज वेल एज यूट्यूब। दीज आर द कॉन्टैक्ट नंबर ऑफ इंस्टीट्यूशन वेर यू कैन कॉल फॉर एग्जाम रिलेटेड admission related inquiries. So without any further delay, let's go into the topic of today. The first topic that we are going to discuss today is AWEBS, the full form being Association of World Election Body. So that means it is the largest and it happens to be the first association of election bodies across the world. So election bodies in the sense, like we have Election Commission of India, the other bodies of the election bodies of other countries are included in it. It was established in the year 2019 in Songdo, and its headquarters is in Seoul, that is also in South Africa. The reason being, AWEBS in news is that India would have completed the first year of its chairmanship of AWEBS. So that is the reason why it's in news. This chairmanship is for the year 2019 to 2022. So RCR, Chief Election Commissioner Suril Arora, happens to be the chair as of now, since he is the Chief Election Commissioner of India. So this chairmanship has been inherited from the country Romania. So coming to AWEBS, it has around 150 countries are members and 20 members as associate members. Associate members in the sense they take part in the discussion, but they don't have the right to vote. So this is regarding associate members. So they held the important positions in discussions and all. And coming to AWEBS, the major objective of AWEBS is free, fair, transparent, and participative democracy worldwide. So this is the major aim of AWEBS. So their slogan happens to be also the same. The slogan of AWEBS is democracy to grow for all worldwide. This is their slogan. So their major objective is to bring sustainable democracy. So everyone should be participating in electoral process, and those things are the major responsibility of AWEBS. So coming to India and AWEBS, it is now seen that India has been the current chair of AWEBS. Also, it is to be noted that India has has conducted the fourth general assembly meeting of AWEBS would have happened in India in Bangalore. Also, it is to be noted that India happens to be the executive member of AWEBS since its inspection. It was inspected in 2013. So it for its formation as well, actually it was its formation was proposed by South Korea initially, but from that time India has been involved in it. So from 2 years it has, from its inspection, for 2 years it has been in the executive body from 2013 to 15, as well as 2015 to 17, for two consecutive years it was there. Then now it is holding the chairmanship, and it will resume its executive board member of the year 2021 to 23 as well. So coming to other thing, it was also to be noted that there happens to be an international conference on initiatives and challenges of social media and IT in elections. That conference was also to be held. So this is regarding AWEBS and AWEBS and India. So let's see. One more thing would have been proposed by our election commissioner Sunil Arora. So what it was said is that he proposed to set up a AWEB, that is AWEBS Center, which is to be having its headquarters in Bangalore. This was all discussed in the General Assembly meeting. So what it was discussed in the meeting of Bangalore, but its headquarters was to be in New Delhi. Sorry, I misspelled it as the Bangalore headquarters, but its headquarters is to be in New Delhi at the International Institute of Democracy and election management. This institute is in Delhi, and this AWEBS center is to be, its headquarters is to be in this institute, which is in Delhi. So the major aim of this center is proper documentation, research sharing, and training of new election staff so that the best electoral and democratic practices will be shared among the countries of this AWEB. So this is all to basically promote democracy in a very sustainable manner. So this is the major aim of AWEBS. So let's go into this is how the vision of AWEB is there. So vision is to foster effectiveness and efficiency in conducting free, fair, and transparent elections worldwide. So this is the vision of AWEBS, as well as how it is done is that to identify what are the challenges in conducting these democratic electoral management processes. These are all done. And to bring in expertise, it uses the information and communication technologies. All of the things are included in it to bring free and fair election, thereby bringing sustainable democracy. So few initiatives are there that are done by India. So India, in the free and fair elections, there are many initiatives that are there. Let's see one by one. So for the first initiative, first it is made that when a person comes for nomination, it is seen that he gives all the required details like educational qualification, cases pending against him, the salary he gets or the income he gets, properties details. He has to register. And this will be published in the newspaper so that people will be aware of the whereabouts of the candidate they are about to vote. So this one is done to ensure that election is transparent. Second thing comes, the person has to take the oath that whatever information he is furnishing are correct. While filing nomination itself, he has to take this oath. So this also ensures that there is accountability of the candidate So during elections and before the end of election, it is seen that the model code of conduct, that is, it is the rules for conduct of free and fair election, is enforced. So election commission sees to is that this moral code of conduct is enforced. Then comes the electoral bonds, which also is the funding pattern for electoral bonds that we have discussed. So it's the funding pattern for elections. So it brings about transparency in funding to the political parties. So political parties, it brings about transparency so that there is no biasness towards a certain section of people. So this is one thing that is to ensure free and fair elections. Then comes an initiative that is to support the voters, the people who are about to vote. Other few initiatives are done by the Election Commission, which is the sweep initiative. So, idalam paathomna National Voters Day anik vandirukku. So, the information here to be given is National Voters Day, which is observed on 25th of Jan. So, this initiative was brought in 2019, a National Voters Day of 2019, that the sweep initiative was bought in. So what does it does Abdin Pakambode? This is celebrated from 2011. Actually, Election Commission of India would have Election Commission of India would have been set up in the year 1951 for the conducting elections on the ECA Namaidu Pandro. On this day it was actually set up. So from 2011, this 25th of Jan is celebrated as the National Voters Day. So this is regarding National Voters Day. So adula vandhathu this 2019 sweep abingira or initiative has been set up. Basically this initiative is to bring in awareness to people or voters, whatever you say. So avangalukku vandhathu we are going to educate voters as to how the electoral practices are to be, the importance of their voting, and to make them participate in the electoral processes. So this is the flagship program of ECI. Flagship in the sense, the most important program of ECI to bring in awareness among the people about conduct of elections as well as their voting rights and those things. இது ஒரு இனிஷியேட்டிவ். அனதர் ஒன் இனிஷியேட்டிவ் இஸ் த கம்யூனிட்டி ரேடியோ ஸ்டேஷன் விச் ஆர் ஆல்சோ லான்ச்ட் ஆன் த சேம் 2019 நேஷனல் ஓட்டர்ஸ் டே. கம்யூனிட்டி ரேடியோ ஸ்டேஷன், திஸ் இஸ் ஆல்சோ டு இன்ஃபார்ம் அண்ட் மேக் அவேர் ஆஃப் த ஓட்டர்ஸ் அபவுட் த எலக்ட்ரல் ப்ராசஸஸ் அண்ட் அபவுட் த கேண்டிடேட்ஸ் அண்ட் அதுக்காக. ஸோ திஸ் கம்யூனிட்டி ரேடியோஸ் பேசிக்லி தே டிஸ்கஸ் அபவுட் த மோஸ்ட் ட்ரெண்டிங் நியூஸ் ஆஃப் தட் லொக்காலிட்டி. ஸோ ஒவ்வொரு லொக்காலிட்டியில இருக்கிறது. ஸோ அந்த 2019ல வாட் வுட் தே ஹவ் டன் இஸ் தட் தே வுட் ஹவ் இன் எலெக்ஷன் கமிஷன் ஆஃப் இந்தியா வுட் ஹவ் பாட் அரௌண்ட் 150 கம்யூனிட்டி ரேடியோ ஸ்டேஷன்ஸ் இன் டூ இது. ஸோ ரீச் டு அட்லீஸ்ட் ரீச் டு அப் டு 150 கம்யூனிட்டி ரேடியோ ஸ்டேஷன்ஸ் ஸோ இன் டூ ஆப்ரேஷன். இதுதான் வந்துட்டு இது. ஸோ இது வந்து ப்ராட்காஸ்டிங் ஆஃப் த மோஸ்ட் ட்ரெண்டிங் கண்டென்ட் ஆஃப் தட் ஏரியா, அது ஒன்று. So this is one thing. So now the election commission, the national voters day oda theme enna appdin paakumbodhu, the theme of present, that is 2020 national voters day enna paakumbodhu, making our voters empowered, vigilant, since it's a corona pandemic, safe and informed. Elections vandu ellathil nadandirukku. So for that, this 2021 they have given this theme: voters vigilant, empowered, vigilant, safe and informed. So this is for basically for corona pandemic time, so they should be safe, and there has been elections in four states. Adukaga majora vandu to that was kept in mind and this theme was formulated, and to bring in active and participatory voters during elections. So இந்த இதுல வந்துட்டு என்ன 2021 இதுல என்ன பண்ணிருக்காங்கன்னா, இசிஐ ஹாஸ் பாட் வெப் ரேடியோ. ஸோ வெப் ரேடியோ டு பிரிங் இன் அவேர்னஸ் ஆஸ் வெல் அஸ் இட் இஸ் செட் தட் தேர் வில் பி நேஷனல் அவார்ட்ஸ் ஃப்ரம் திஸ் இயர் ஆன்வர்ட்ஸ். நேஷனல் அவார்ட்ஸ் வந்துட்டு கொடுக்க போறாங்க ஃபார் பெஸ்ட் ஸ்டேட்ஸ், பெஸ்ட் எலக்டோரல் ப்ராக்டிசஸ், ஹூ கண்டக்ட் ப்ராப்பர் எலெக்ஷன்ஸ், ப்ராப்பர் ஃப்ரீ அண்ட் ஃபேர் எலெக்ஷன் வித் ஸ்டேட் இஸ் கண்டக்டிங். அதுக்காக வந்து பெஸ்ட் எலக்டோரல் ப்ராக்டிசஸ்க்கு பிரசிடென்ட் இஸ் கோயிங் டு கன்ஃபர் அவார்ட்ஸ். ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் ஆல் அபவுட் ஏவெப்ஸ் அண்ட் ஹவ் சர்டன் இனிஷியேட்டிவ்ஸ் பை எலெக்ஷன் கமிஷன் ஆஃப் இந்தியா டு கண்டக்ட் ஃப்ரீ அண்ட் ஃபேர் எலெக்ஷன். ஸோ தி ஸ்வீப் இனிஷியேட்டிவ் தட் கேன் பி டைரக்ட்லி ஆஸ் இன் த எக்ஸாமினேஷன். டைரக்டாகவே வந்துட்டு ஸ்வீப் இனிஷியேட்டிவ் இஸ் ரிலேட்டட் டு ஆர் இஸ் கண்டக்டட் பை விச் பாடி அப்படிங்கறதெல்லாமே வந்துட்டு இட் கேன் பி டைரக்ட்லி ஆஸ்க் பை த directly as in the examination. So this is all about AWeb. So next news ku polam. So the next news is MEE, full form mandate management of effective evaluation of protected areas. So idu vandu gives a detail, it's a key tool that is used by the national and international bodies to understand the strengths and weaknesses of protected area management system. So how the protected area is managed, whether they go through some ethical practices for protecting, illana values eda form irukkaangala for protecting the ecosystem and the biodiversity management. So in the protected areas na the national park, wildlife sanctuary, appra vandu community reserves, adukapra vandu other protected areas like marine protected parks. ஸோ இந்த மாதிரி இருக்கிற எல்லா பார்க்ஸையும், பேர்த் சான்ச்சுரிஸ், ஜூஸ், ஃபார் எவ்ரி திங் திஸ் இஸ் தேர். ஸோ இட் இஸ் கோயிங் டு சி வாட் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் ப்ராக்டிசஸ், வாட் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் வேல்யூஸ் ஆர் இன்ஹெரிட்டட் இன் தீஸ் ப்ரொடெக்ஷன் ஆஃப் த ப்ரொடெக்டட் ஏரியா அப்படின்னு சொல்லிட்டு தே ஆர் கோயிங் டு சி த்ரூ திஸ் எம்இஇ. ஸோ த ரீசன் பிஹைண்ட் எம்இஇ நியூஸ் இஸ் த ஃபர்ஸ்ட் திங் இஸ் அரவுண்ட் 146 நேஷனல் பார்க்ஸ் அண்ட் வைல்ட் லைஃப் சான்ச்சுரிஸ் have been released. The report of these 146 national parks and wildlife sanctuaries, this MEE, this evaluation has been released by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. Second thing vandu paathomna nama MEE zoo and MEE for marine protected areas, adu marine parks vandu nama kondu vandirukom. So these are the two reasons why this MEE is in news and it becomes important. So coming to this, ME has been eppadina evaluation has been done based on four categories of rating. First one vandu poor rating, which is for up to 40%. up to 40% this is given, ratings assigned in four categories. Second comes the fair, how the performance, the how the idu vandu maintain avudhu, so strength evlo irukudhu abingira performance idu pandrathukku. So best and worst performing national parks and wildlife sanctuaries um illa kudukranga adha based upon the protection level. Then comes fair, which is 41 to 59. Then comes good, which is 50 60 to 74, and above 75 is very good. So this is regarding how they are they were done. And this assessment of India's national park and wildlife sanctuary is based on assessment, this MA assessment is based on IUCN's World Commission on Protected Areas framework of MEE. So adha base panida in the assessment for India is done. So let's go on to this MEE zoo. Let's see what is MEE zoo. MEE zoo ngaradhu nothing, it is like how the zoos are protected in a independent, discrete and holistic manner la how it is done abdin solittu we are going to see. So we are going to evaluate these zoos based in a manner which is discrete, holistic and independent. So we are going to give the guidelines and criteria as well as the indicators for evaluation of these zoo. Then it is from a in the zoo idu pandrathu vandu paathomna it moves towards many other standards. It doesn't cover like basic standards like whether the area is sufficient andha maadhiri mattu illama we are going to check some core values, like we are going to include some criteria like animal welfare and then animal husbandry, sustainability of resources, whether they have proper water resources and whether the tree cover and those things adala proper ah irukuda, and animals whether that is sufficient, those resources are sufficient for those animals to live in, those things are going to be checked in MEE zoo. So it's moving towards the highest standards and to adhere to the core values of accountability, transparency. We are going to bring in technology innovations and we are going to bring in many organization that works for conservation of endangered species. Those things are also brought into it. Coming to MEE marine parks, it is a initiative by joint initiative by Wildlife Institute of India plus Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, so MOEFCC. So these are the organization involved. So direct kekla MEE marine national park is a joint initiative of abdin solittu, it can be a direct question. So coming to India and MEE, it is seen that India has a India has a network of around 903 protected areas, which covers about 5% of the total geographical area. And India's performance is good. It is higher than the global mean score of 56%. India is around 62%. That too, the eastern region has performed really well in this mean score. So their protection level on the way they are doing the holding the values are high in protecting these national parks and wildlife sanctuaries. So this is about India and MEE. Coming to which national parks and wildlife sanctuary has performed well, if we will see, the highest performance is by the Great Himalayan National Park, which is in Himachal Pradesh region. Its score is, if you will see, it is around 84%. This 84% is by Great Himalayan National Park and Tirthan Wildlife Sanctuary. This Tirthan Wildlife Sanctuary is also connected. This wildlife sanctuary is connected with this national park. Both are showing a good level of performance, around 84%, which is very good, which comes under very good category. So this is Himachal Pradesh. So see all these national parks since they are in news. So see where they are located. So for places on idhila vandu it's places in news are important. So if you see Jaldapra, it is in West Bengal. Rainganj is also wildlife sanctuary, it's in West Bengal. Himachal Pradesh la vandu Sains, Great Himalayas as well as Tirthan. All the three are in Himachal Pradesh. There is a difference between wildlife sanctuary and national park. Wildlife sanctuary vandu we can designate it for a specific species, but national park is for many species together, combined together. So adna is a difference. So this Great Himalayas is in Kulu region of Himachal Pradesh. So it's also a UNESCO designated World Heritage Site. Okay, and it was established in the year 1989. 84 as a national park. Coming to this Tirthan Wildlife Sanctuary, Tirthan Wildlife Sanctuary, it's a part of this Seraj forest region, and it's also in Himachal Pradesh. It was declared as a wildlife sanctuary in 1976. It is connected to this Great Himalayan National Park. So this is regarding the best performance. Coming to the bottom 5 sport or the poor category, adhila paathamna, if you will see this Turtle Wildlife Sanctuary. This Turtle Wildlife Sanctuary is in UP. So it also has another name. This is the comparatively idu vandittu paathomna comparative the lowest performer is da. So it also has another name enna na Kachua Sanctuary adin solli solluva Kachua. So it's in UP. So if you will see, this happens to be the only sanctuary which is dedicated protected area for freshwater turtle in the world. Freshwater turtles, this is the only dedicated sanctuary in the world. So, but there has been a problem in this. Actually, this sanctuary, the reason for which is it has been created, it is not fulfilling the purpose of its creation. Adhanala, the state government would have set, proposed for denotifying this wildlife sanctuary, this Kachua sanctuary. Denotify pannan solranga, but if it get denotified, then it will be a national wildlife sanctuary which has become completely eradicated as a either. So it will become either. So the reason behind is that turtles, only 5 species of turtles are found in the sanctuary. It is along the Ganga river, but inga paathomna only 5 species vandu irukudhu. So this is not fulfilling the purpose. It has the, it is not, wildlife sanctuary, it has to protect the freshwater turtles, but it is not fulfilling the purpose. So that is the reason why the state government has asked for denotification of this sanctuary. So this is regarding the ME initiative that is there in news. So coming to this ME initiatives and those things and the protection of these, we need to basically know about who in India la eppadi irukku performance all over, how is the performance. These are the things that is important that we have to know. So let's move on to the next issue. So the next issue is about Panna Tiger Reserve. Coming to Panna Tiger Reserve, it's present in the northern part of MP. It is in the situated in the Vindhya Range. India range la northern part of MP. Okay, so coming to why it's in news, the basic reason behind this Panna Tiger Reserve in news is that this has been included in the UNESCO World Network of Biosphere Reserves. So UNESCO oda World Network of Biosphere Reserves la vandu this Panna Tiger Reserve has been included. So this makes it to be the 12th reserve to be included, by biosphere reserve to be included in this. Actually, this was declared as a biosphere reserve in 2011 by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. So after this many years, this Panna atmos 9 years, 2020 la declare panirpaanga into a UNESCO World Network of Biosphere Reserve la. So this becomes important. So and this this biosphere reserve has been also recognized by UNESCO as a critical wildlife habitat. So idhukku sila significance irukku. From Madhya Pradesh, this happens to be the third biosphere reserve after Panchmati and Amarkantak. So please note the names of this country. See, if you see, this is in Panchmati. This Amarkantak and Achakmanar is between Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh. So this becomes important. So this happens to be the third biosphere reserve. So totally there are in India there are 18 biosphere reserves, but UNESCO World Network of Biosphere Reserve la vandu paathomna there are 12, and this Panna Tiger Reserve happens to be the 12th tiger reserve. So this can be asked in the elimination questions, it becomes important. So state the biosphere reserve which are not included in, which does not form a part of World Network of Biosphere Reserve அப்படின்னு சொல்லிட்டு கேட்கலாம். ஸோ இஃப் இஃப் ஃபார் தீஸ் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் குவெஸ்டின் பிளீஸ் நோ த அதர் சிக்ஸ் விச் ஆர் நாட் தேர், வி கான்ட் ரிமெம்பர் ஆல் த 12. ஸோ பெட்டர் டு நோ த சிக்ஸ் விச் ஆர் நாட் பார்ட் ஆஃப் திஸ் வேர்ல்ட் நெட்ஒர்க் ஆஃப் பயோஸ்பியர் ரிசர்வ். ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் ரிகார்டிங் தி பன்னா பன்னா டைகர் ரிசர்வ், இட் ஹாஸ் பீன் இன்க்ளூடட். ஸோ கம்மிங் டு திஸ் ஒன் மோர் திங் அபவுட் திஸ் பன்னா டைகர் ரிசர்வ் இஸ் தட் த கென் ரிவர் ஃப்ளோஸ் த்ரூ திஸ் பயோஸ்பியர் ரிசர்வ் அண்ட் இட் ஆல்சோ த கென் பெட்வா ரிவர் லிங்கிங் ப்ராஜெக்ட் இஸ் கனெக்டிங் திஸ் பன்னா டைகர் ரிசர்வ் அண்ட் தட் வுட் ஹவ் அட்ராக்டட் அப்போசிஷன் since it passes through the Panna Tiger Reserve, this interlinking project, it would have been a problem to the people who are dwelling in those regions as well as the animals which are dependent on this and the biosphere reserve. That is one thing. And one more thing is that coming to Madhya Pradesh, if you will see Madhya Pradesh, it is seen that Madhya Pradesh has the highest tiger population. According to tiger estimates, Madhya Pradesh, all India tiger estimation body, Madhya Pradesh has the highest tiger population. That is followed by Karnataka and Uttarakhand. Uttarakhand comes third. So this is regarding this, and this is all about Panna Tiger Reserve. Coming to World Network of Biosphere Reserve, if you will see, this World Network of Biosphere Reserve is initiated in 1971. UNESCO Man and Biosphere Program. Major aim of this Man and Biosphere Program is to bring in scientifically based relationship between man and his environment. So to establish a link between man and the environment. It's an intergovernmental scientific program. So this initiative not only conserves the flora and fauna, but also the people who are dependent on the reserves or the protected areas. So this is the importance of this scheme. Like the tribal people who are dependent on these areas. So, angling protect pannadu. And the WNBR is a part of this Man and Biosphere program. So, it is for obtaining the international cooperation in conserving the biosphere reserve. So, from India, Nilgiris happens to be the first biosphere reserve which was included in the World Network of Biosphere Reserve. So, this is regarding World Network of Biosphere Reserve, sir. Which was the Man and Biosphere Reserve was established in 1971. So this is regarding the complete entire Panna Tiger Reserve and the related data. So let's move on to the next issue. So the next issue is about Asiatic lions. Asiatic lions ye news la irukku appdi paakum bodhu idu lion census nadandirukum. Lion census happens every 5 years. So 2015 la last census would have happened. Due to pandemic, this census for 2020 would have been shifted to 2021 on the release data. So, this is the data release, it would have been delayed due to pandemic. And it would have seen that the Asiatic lion population has increased. Compared to 2015 level, now the population has increased. Comparing to this 2015 level. So, this year, how the census has happened is through பூனம் அவலோக்கன் அப்படின்னு சொல்லி சொல்றோம். பூனம் அவலோக்கன்ல வந்துட்டு வி ஆர் கோயிங் டு டெசிக்னேட் ஃபியூ பர்சன் ஹூ ஆர் கோயிங் டு ட்ராக் த டைகர் பாப்புலேஷன். ஸோ இட்ஸ் கோயிங் டு பி, இஃப் யூ வில் சி, இட்ஸ் கோயிங் டு பி அ இன்ஹவுஸ் சர்வே. ஸோ இட்ஸ் பேசிக்கலி அ இன்ஹவுஸ் அப்சர்வேஷனல் எக்ஸசைஸ். அதான் பூனம் இது பூனம் அவலோக்கனோட பேசிக்கான ஒரு இது. இட்ஸ் அ இன்ஹவுஸ் எக்ஸசைஸ் தட் இஸ் ஹேப்பனிங். Due to pandemic, this is happening. The reason behind is that, namma yen paathomna, in a national, in a zoo in America, basically what would have happened is, a tigress would have contracted this coronavirus. That is the reason why they would have not, there is no advice to carry out this census involving many number of people. Adnala, the Poonam Avlokan valiya, it is going to be a, in-house monitoring survey madri. So based upon this, we are going to see how the tiger lion population, and it is seen that it has increased. And one more information is about this Asiatic lion is that it is confined only in the Gujarat region. So basically, Gir forest la vandu nariya their population is there, and it is seen there the population has increased in Gir forest as well as their area of their spread has also increased. So these are the two things which we need to note from this survey. And other thing is that this coming to this Asiatic lion, it's an endangered species and protected under Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 as well as sites. Name is Panthera leoparisica, and there is another lion species called African lion species. So compared to African lion species, these Asiatic lion species are small. And one more thing, when you enna abdin paakumbodhu, this Asiatic lion species has a skin fold. Okayla, along their idu abdomen belly region la paathomna skin fold irukum. That is uniqueness of this Asiatic lion species, and that is the difference between African and Asiatic lion. So they say certain things are there for conservation of this Asiatic lion species. Even Project Tiger Project Tiger basis la Project Lion vandu there would have been a proposal for Project Lion as well. So coming to this conservation, Asiatic Lion Conservation Project by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change for 3 financial years vandu propose panirukanga, covering 2018 to 3 years ku vandu 3 financial years ku vandu it has been covered, covering 2018 to 2021. So this we need to know since idu vandu ipo inda year oda mudiyudu. So this financial years ku vandu commit panirukanga, and basically idla enna panna porona, we are going to enhance the habitat of the tiger, like habitat improvement da idoda basic idu of this conservation. And like habitat improvement in the sense, we are going to provide them with water resources, food and fodder, whatever they require adha panna porom. Then comes the relocation and translocation of these Asiatic lions, basically Gujarat to MP, because earlier these lions were spread across MP and West Bengal as well, but now it is confined to Gujarat only. So adanal the Madhya Pradesh region we are going to shift. In Madhya Pradesh, the sanctuary which is suitable for the ecosystem and everything is suitable for this lion vandu paathomna Kuno Palpur. So this was asked in UPSC 2019, if I'm not wrong, 2019 paper la vandu Kuno Palpur sanctuary pathi there was a question. The relocation of translocation of Asiatic lions is to which wildlife sanctuary, which proposed to which wildlife sanctuary abdingra madri. So it's the Kuno Palpur wildlife sanctuary da it is going to be translocated. Adavadhu if it's going to be translocated, then it will be done here. So the basic reason behind translocation enna abdin paathomna, first thing is these lions are confined only to Gujarat region. So if a animal gets affected by a disease or something, then it will destroy the whole population, it can spread to the whole population. For example, the canine distemper virus. So in the canine distemper virus paathomna, it has killed around many animals, around 18 animals in this 12 to 18 animals it has killed, lions have been killed panirukke. It is a very contagious viral disease, basically it spreads from dogs, so from through waters or the food which the infected animal has taken, if the healthy animal comes and take adu mulyamana, it is spreading. And how it would affect in eda affect panadhu abin paakumbodhu, it affects the respiratory gas, gastrointestinal tracts, adellathiyume vandu it's affecting, and it's a contagious disease. So it has led to death of many animals. So this is one of the reason. And for relocation, so to maintain the animal, to bring adavadhu save and conserve the animal, this translocation and relocation has been proposed. Also there has been a opposition to this census. The census says that the lion population has increased, but recent findings have shown, certain records have shown that because of this canine distemper virus and one more disease called babesiosis and a flash flood that has occurred, there have been reports that many lions have died. So idinala there is a chance that it's overestimated data abdin solittu solranga. And also this data is just done by the Poonam avlokan vandu paathana, it's just done by sighting by the human beings andha maari dhaan pandranga. So it can give misleading data abdin solittu solranga. Generally how lions are taken, counts of line are taken abin paakumbodhu, it's done by a block method. Block method na a camera will be fit near this water sources. There it will be fitted, and when the animal comes for taking water or drinking water, that time it will record the information like how many and the madri. But this also can give misleading data, because an animal can come 2-3 times. The same animal can come 2-3 times. That doesn't mean the number has increased. So innume vandittu camera footings vandu we should make it proper. Then other kind of like technology should be infused, like when the M strips, we are having M strips for tigers and the madri, and pug marks use panni we are calculating. So these kind of fecal remains, elephants la vandu we used to detect through fecal remains, elephants and all the animals fecal remains vechittu. So these kind of much more enhanced and the authentic data has to be collected abingiradhu da vandittu a field by few other persons. And this lion happens to be a among the 5 Pantheria cat species that is inheriting India. So the other 4 yar yar and the species in paathomna, this panthera in the sense this name, this species name. So idhula vandha nama tigers la irukra maadhiri, one is the bengal tiger, then comes the 3 leopard species, basically Indian leopard, snow leopard and clouded leopard. So these are the 4 species along with this Asiatic lion. These Asiatic lions are also called as Indian lions or Persian lions. So let's move on to the next issue. The next issue is about ice flows is nothing but integrated flood management system. So it's a early flood management early warning system. So floods ka early warning system. So recent Mumbai la vandittu we have integrated this have this system, and it's being developed in Bengaluru and Kolkata as well. It has to come. So Bengaluru and Kolkata also is being developed. So Mumbai happens to be the second state after Chennai to get this system. Basically Mumbai has been the basic la paathomna, why the reason behind this is proposed is that urban flooding happens to be the major reason. Causes of urban flooding paakumbodhu high rainfalls, natural causes la vandu high rainfalls, adukapra vandu it can be due to some disasters like earthquakes and the madri disasters. So and vandu man made idhula vandu encroachments and river encroachments panite we are building many buildings over there, adu vandu idhuva irukalam. So flats and other things, as well as cutting down of these forests, these also happens to be sand mining can be a reason which can lead to this urban flooding. And drainage system, improper drainage system, lack of proper drainage system, these are all some of the factors of urban flooding. Okay, so it leads to uncontrolled flooding, and Mumbai happens to be the financial capital of India, but over there is the floods that is happening is very severe. So that is the reason why Mumbai has got this early warning system, integrated flood management system. It's a joint initiative by Ministry of Earth Sciences and Brihan Mumbai Municipal Corporation. So these two are involved in this. So what is that? Does it so it's going to give data or 3 days ku vandu it's going to give a data from vandu 6 to 72 hours beyond lende we are going to get this data of 2 eye flows valiya we are going to get this data 6 to 72 hours keep that over 3 days period around 3 days period la we are going to get this data to so that we can detect the flood incidents and we can take the necessary precautionary measures and we can save ourselves as well as the resources. So this is the reason why this eye flood is in use, and it is said that there has to be an integrated flood management system all throughout the country. The reason being that even the northeastern states, in recent time there has been severe flooding in the northeastern state. Assam la paathoma there has been severe flooding, as well as Kerala has also faced severe flooding. So this is the reason why our government is proposing for a integrated flood management system throughout the country. So this is all about eye flood. So directly there can be a question, eye flows is related to flood management systems, இல்லைனா வந்துட்டு இன்டர்லிங்கிங் ஆஃப் ரிவர்ஸ், ஸோ த டேம்ஸ் அந்த இது ஃப்ளோக்காக இது பண்ணலாம். ஸோ அந்த மாதிரி தேர் கேன் பி க்வெஸ்டன்ஸ். ஸோ ஜஸ்ட் டைரக்ட் க்வெஸ்டன்ஸ் வில் பி ஆஸ்க். ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் ரிகார்டிங் ஐ க்ளோஸ். லெட்ஸ் மூவ் ஆன் டு த நெக்ஸ்ட் இஷ்யூஸ். ஸோ நெக்ஸ்ட் இஷ்யூ இஸ் ஆன் டிஜிட்டல் ஓஷன். ஸோ டிஜிட்டல் ஓஷன் இஸ் த வெப் பேஸ்ட் அப்ளிகேஷன் தட் இஸ் இனாக்ரேட்டட் பை மினிஸ்ட்ரி ஆஃப் எர்த் சயின்சஸ் அஸ் வெல் அஸ் மினிஸ்ட்ரி ஆஃப் ஹெல்த் அண்ட் ஃபேமிலி வெல்ஃபேர், பட் இட் இஸ் டிசைன்ட் பை இன்கோயஸ். ஸோ கம்மிங் டு திஸ் டிஜிட்டல் ஓஷன், த பேசிக் அப்ஜெக்டிவ் ஆஃப் திஸ் டிஜிட்டல் ஓஷன் இஸ் டு கெட் த ஓஷன் டேட்டா மேனேஜ்மெண்ட் பிளாட்ஃபார்ம். இட் ஹேப்பன்ஸ் டு பி த சிங்கிள் பிளாட்ஃபார்ம் வேர் ஆல் த ஓஷன் ரிலேட்டட் இன்ஃபர்மேஷன் வில் பி ஸ்டோர்ட். So it becomes easier for tapping the blue economy. Various missions require to tap the ocean resources and everything, kind of like deep ocean mission, which has other initiative like deep sea fishing. It comes under this deep ocean. It's a parent mission. Adukla paathomna deep sea fishing, and then the polymetallic nodules, we are going to tap those resources under underwater tapping of resources. Idellame nadakka podu. So in a way it's a method to tap the blue economy, as well as it helps in capacity building as well. So capacity building of this Indian Ocean Rim countries. So adhikalam it is going to help. And also we can predict the weather system. Like when then if on the in the cyclonic trends, adhellame also we can predict. So this happens to be a all in all one platform which gives the complete data of oceans. So that is developed, which is developed by Incois. So coming to Incois, it's a Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services. So it's an autonomous organization under Ministry of Earth Sciences, established in the year 1999, and it is located in Hyderabad, and it happens to be a unit of Earth System Service Organization, which is executive arm of Earth Sciences, and it's located in New Delhi. And coming to this ESO, this gives the weather related information, forecast of weather, climate change, everything is given by this organization. So it happens to be the all in all in giving information tracking for our country. So this is all about Incois and Digital Ocean. So let's move on to the next issue. So the next issue is about Pradhan Mantri Bharatiya Jan Aushadhi Pariyojana. Coming to Jan Aushadhi Pariyojana, this is basically launched by Department of Pharmaceuticals, which is under Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers. Is the ministry under which it comes. Fertilizer. So this mission was launched as a campaign. So Jan Aushadhi campaign in the year 2008. Later it was revamped as Pradhan Mantri Bharatiya Jan Aushadhi Pariyojana in the year 2015-16. So basically the reason being it in news is that the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers would have given a comprehensive review. It would have set a comprehensive review meeting of how the scheme is performing. The reason behind this scheme is to bring awareness about the generic medicine and to extend the coverage of quality medicine, that is to make sure that every person get quality medicine, and it is especially done on the generic medicine. So, and it also makes sure that these medicines are available at an affordable price to all, so that it will decrease the out-of-pocket expenditure. Out-of-pocket expenditure, it is paid by the individual directly to the healthcare, directly for healthcare. Paid directly by the individual to healthcare. That means that the insurance coverage is not full or it is not there. So that is the meaning of this out-of-pocket expenditure. So it is seen that India is one of the India is one of the countries which has highest out-of-pocket expenditure. It is about three times the global average. The global average is around 18%. இந்தியாஸ் வந்து பார்த்தோம்னா இட் இஸ் அரௌண்ட் 62%. ஸோ இட் இஸ் மோர் தேன் 3 times த குளோபல் ஆவரேஜ். இட் இஸ் திஸ் டேட்டா இஸ் கிவன் இன் த எக்கனாமிக் சர்வே ஆஃப் திஸ் இயர். ஸோ 2020-21 எக்கனாமிக் சர்வேல வந்துட்டு இட் இஸ் தேர். ஸோ இன்சூரன்ஸ் டசன்ட் கவர். ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் ஒன் ஆஃப் த திங்க. ஸோ பேசிக்கலி திஸ் ஸ்கீம் இஸ் இம்ப்ளிமெண்டட் பை பியூரோ ஆஃப் ஃபார்மா பிஎஸ்யூ சார், which was established in the year 2000, and it also functions under Department of Pharmaceuticals of Chemicals and Fertilizers, and it happens to be a independent society, established as an independent society. So coming to these drugs which are these generic drugs and idala irukku illaya, so basically these are provided through the Jan Aushadhi Kendras. So this is this Kendras vandittu for are set up to provide these generic drugs. So in the Kendras vandu paathana drugs which are provided, they are tested by the national agriculture laboratories which are aggregated to NABL. So on the aggregated labs valiya dhaan these medicines are generic medicines are being tested, and it ensures that these medicines are in compliance with WHO good manufacturing practices standards. So adu ellathin complaint WHO oda idoda compliance iruka appdin paathadhu dhaan these data is these medicines are sold. And coming to one more information, there is Jan Aushadhi week which is celebrated from 1st to 7th March. This is basically to bring in awareness about the generic medicines to people and make them to buy these medicines. So buy quality medicines ellathukume. And also there is a application called Jan Aushadhi Sugam application. So what this does is that this app does is that it gives the location of the Jan Aushadhi Kendra. There's a nearby location. Google Maps, it gives the nearby location. Then it is also helpful in checking whether the generic medicines is available in the that pharmacy or the Kendras, whether it is available there. So, and to know about, basically to know about the stock as well as to know, create awareness about this generic medicines. And coming to who can set up these Jan Aushadhi Kendra, government grants about 2.5 lakhs for people to set this Jan Aushadhi Kendra, which can be set by doctors, self-help groups, then the NGOs. Either it can be, the location can be chosen by them. So wherever it is possible for setting, suitable space that is possible for setting these, they can set up there, and it can be inside or outside the hospital premises. So this is about Pradhan Mantri Bharatiya Jan Aushadhi Pariyojana. So one more thing in this is that this Jan Aushadhi Kendras are also permitted to sell Ayush medicines as well, like the Ayurveda Siddha, those medicines as well can be sold as well as then this brings about not only self-reliance, like Atmanirbhar, generic drugs are nothing but the bioequivalent of the normal drugs. So their effects, their procedure, everything is same. The molecule present are, everything is same. But the only difference between generic and these branded drugs is that the price difference. And also the reason behind why the price of these drugs are less is that actually when a drug manufacturer or a company which manufactures drugs produces a drug, what is that is it gets the patents for those drugs. So when it gets the patent, no one will be able to produce those drugs. But the thing is that once this patent expires, the other companies makes use of these formulas to make the drug. Since it's a already proven drug, whose efficacy has not to be proven again, producing these drugs becomes much easier and at a much lower rate. So therefore, the difference is that generic drugs are same in their components, are same in the effects they create, and also same in the side effects or whatever it is. Everything is same except one is that they have lesser price. but lesser price doesn't mean lesser quality. They are prepared with the same kind of efficacy that the brand name has. Since it's associated with the brands, the research costs and everything adds to the branded drugs. That is the only difference. And one more thing is that this Pradhan Mantri Bharatiya Jan Aushadhi Pariyojana, it also helps in employment, bringing in more employment into India. So these are some of the importance of this Pradhan Mantri Bharatiya Jan Aushadhi Yojana. And to decrease this out-of-pocket expenditure, it is said that in the National Health Policy says that the contribution to healthcare in the budget has to be increased to 2.5%, so that this can bring about out-of-pocket expenditure to 30%, which is now at 60%. So this was given in the National Health Policy, 2017 policy, this was stated, so from 65 to 30%. So let's move on to the next issue. So the next issue is regarding Dehing Patkai. So Dehing Patkai is a national park which is located in Assam. So the reason behind it in being used is that it has been upgraded to a national park. It was a wildlife sanctuary which was upgraded to a national park. The reason behind its upgradation is that to stop coal mining. So this wildlife sanctuary, there were coal reserves which was heavily mined. To stop that, this was transferred to a national park so that it attracts high degree of protection. In wildlife sanctuary, there can be certain kind of operation that can go on in wildlife sanctuary, but national park completely prohibits any kind of interference to protect the ecosystem. So coming to Dehing Patkai, it is called as the Amazon of East, and it is also spread across stretches till Arunachal Pradesh. So basically it's in Assam but stretches till Arunachal Pradesh, and it happens to be the rainforest, in the sense the evergreen forest. And coming to its name, it is named after the river which flows through the forest, and the Patkai is the hill that is present in the foothills of this national park. Now it's a national park, so hence this is regarding the Dehing Patkai National Park. It's important for places in news. So that, already they have asked about the Phoke Tiger Reserve, where it is present. So it is in Arunachal Pradesh. Like that, they can directly give Dehing Patkai and they can ask where it is located. So this is what is important here, and it has been upgraded to a national park. So let's move on to the next issue. So the next issue is about Ahana. So Ahana is basically a flagship program which ensures that no child is born with HIV or AIDS. Basically, it is to eliminate the mother-to-child transmission of AIDS. So AIDS is basically caused by a virus called human immunovirus, and full form of AIDS is acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. So when the virus attacks and it persists for a long time, it completely damages the human immune system, and thereby it leads to a syndrome called AIDS. So this is how AIDS is caused. And if you will see, AIDS is basically transmitted to bodily fluids. It's the major, it's the only way by which AIDS is transmitted, and there is no cure for AIDS as of now. So if you will come to further details, World AIDS Day is celebrated on 1st of December, and the theme for World AIDS Day is, for this year it has been, last 2020, it's been Global Solidarity Resilient HIV Services. So coming to this Ahana, it's to eliminate the mother-to-child transmission. Around 50% of the cases, AIDS has been transmitted from mother to child. So it ensures that till 18 months or so, it gives protection for this, completely avoiding this transmission. And one more thing is that this is done, implemented by Pan India with support from the Global Fund. So this is regarding this Ahana, nothing to go more into this. And it should also be noted here is that on World AIDS Day, during even this COVID-19 pandemic, how to respond to this HIV disease. So this is the major thing that was carried out in the World AIDS Day of 2020. This was being discussed by the global leaders. And there is another initiative for AIDS called as 90:90:90. So this is the target set by WHO. What is ensured is that first 90 states that 90% of the people living with HIV know what their status is. So this is first 90. The second 90 says that whether the people affected has got the required treatment. Are they receiving the treatment is checked in this 90. And the third is that the 90% who are 90% of the all people who are receiving this treatment, have they achieved the viral suppression, whether they have, whether the viral load has decreased in them. These are being checked. And some of the thing for AIDS that is done is antiretroviral therapy is done for AIDS. This is the kind of treatment that is given for a person affected with AIDS and HIV virus. Then there is also this thing called National AIDS Control Program that is also being done. So these are all certain initiatives that are being done for AIDS.